Nick and Albert from the Netherlands will talk about embedded systems, and especially on the topic of the secret boot sequence of embedded systems and what to do to come around this. Okay, give a warm applause to Nick and Albert.
Thank you. Thanks for joining on this early morning. If you would be standing here, I probably wouldn't be in the room because it's very early. So we are Albert and Nick, and we're here to present bypassing secure boot using fault injection. So this talk is consisting of a few subparts. So we will introduce fault injection first, and then we'll give an introduction to what secure boot is. And then Albert will take the word and will actually detail various ways how you can use fault injection to bypass secure boot. We will also touch briefly on the practicalities of an attacker. So when you are actually doing secure boot, what are the things you have to overcome? And also what can you do as an implementer to minimize the risk for these type of attacks? One disclaimer, we're not really talking about UEFI secure boot here. We're really talking about proprietary secure boot implementations that are implemented on embedded systems. So these are typically very different from each other because the vendors are free to implement whatever they want. So we are hackers at Riskier, where we test the security of different types of devices. Riskier both makes and uses tools to perform side channel analysis and fault injection. And besides that, we also do all sorts of projects in order to test the security of software and hardware. And this talk is actually a little bit of both. So we'll be using the tools we create and also the tools we'll be using. And they're actually laying here in front of those, and they will be used during the demo. So first of all, I would like to start with a definition about fault injection when we talk about fault injection. So when we talk about fault injection, it's really changing the intended behavior of a target by introducing a glitch. To give an example what you can do, for example, if you look at this very simple code that is used to open the door based on the validity of a key, using fault injection, we can inject a fault at the if statement, and that allows us to change its intended behavior. And this results in us opening the door without actually having the correct key. But of course, how can these faults be introduced? For the people that were yesterday at the talk of Ramiro and Niels, they introduced fault injection already a little bit, so I will not go into too much detail. But typically, there's multiple techniques in order to change the environmental conditions of a target. And this allows you to inject a glitch. And this actually results in a fault that will create these changes in the intended behavior. And one thing to realize is that these changes can be both in software and in hardware. And another characteristic of fault injection that it's you really have to be external to the chip. So you cannot do it from internal. So you cannot have software running on the device that generates this environmental change, or it's not likely that it's possible. So you really have to do it externally. So to give one brief example, what the basic idea is of a glitch. For example, if we look at the voltage that's provided to, for example, an ARM core, if we make a fast dip in this voltage, it will actually cause a glitch inside the chip, which will result in this change in behavior. And it's important to do this not too soft, because then no change will occur, and not too hard, because then likely the target will not continue anymore. So by doing it not too soft and not too hard, we will affect only the intended behavior at that moment in time, and we do not affect the continuation of the target. So when you do fault injection, there's different things that can go wrong in the target. And this is just some examples. And typically, we like to group the faults in two groups. One that affect hardware that does software. So you can think of a processing core, for example, an ARM core. And the faults that affect hardware that is not directly involved in the execution of software. So for the first group, you can think of changing instructions, not executing instructions. When data is being handled, it is changed. And for the second group, we really talk about hardware that of which the intended behavior is changed. For example, there might be security registers that are somewhere stored inside the chip and that can be affected using fault injection. Or when data is transferred from A to B on the chip using dedicated buses, this might go wrong when you're injecting glitches at that moment in time. One thing to realize is that the true fault model for a given target is very difficult to determine, especially if you want to do it exhaustively. So in order to be able to say something when we're presented by, with code, we take a shortcut. So what we typically do is we just assume the target is vulnerable to instruction corruption. So we are able to arbitrarily change the instructions that are executed. And typically what you can do then is, for example, this. If we look at this MIPS instruction, we see if we flip one bit in the instructions encoding, we actually do not add 8 to the particular register, but we add 0. And also a more complex variant is possible where multiple bits are changed. And this allows us, for example, to change the load instruction into a store instruction. But one thing to realize here is that, of course, you likely have limited control over what bits are going to change. So typically, you cannot know this up front. And also one thing to realize is that even though that this is a nice fault model and it is likely applicable to many targets, it's likely not the only fault model. But the advantage of using this shortcut is that instruction corruption, the behavioral changes that you can have by using this model actually also cover other types of fault models. For example, if a register is read out by software that is not related to the execution of software, it will be the same if that register would be read using a load instruction if we change the store into a store instruction, because then effectively the read will not happen. But in practice, it might even be that only the register actually is glitched and not so much the execution of the software. So this is a shortcut we often use. So how does this go in practice? Well, in order to do voltage fault injection, you need some tooling. And there's open source tooling available that allows you to do this. And since this type of tooling is out, fault injection really became available to the masses. So you do not have to create your own tool anymore. You can use this tool off the shelf and you leverage on the community in order to perform fault injection. At Riskier, we use our own tooling, and typically setup looks a little bit like this. So we have a workstation that is able to communicate with the glitcher, which is the yellow device, and to the target. And in this case, the target is a digital cyber board, which houses a zinc chip, which is a system on chip that includes an ARM Cortex A9 core in order to execute the software. The glitcher has various inputs and outputs, and this is the bare minimum of what we typically use. So there's one output, is just the trigger, which will tell us when to inject the glitch. There's the output, the VCC, so that is the power that is actually powering the power domain that powers the ARM core, that allows us to inject glitches there. We have one GPIO routed into a relay, and this allows us to actually switch the external power supply of the board. So whenever we inject a glitch and the chip gets into an erroneous state, we can reset the target in order to get to a known working state. In practice, the setup looks a little bit more like this. So logically, it looks all fine, but there's a whole bunch of cables connected together, all having their little purpose. And this is roughly what's laying in front of us. We made it a little bit robust, so it would actually still be alive after traveling over the camping, but it's roughly what is laying here in front of us. So what we're running on the target in order to determine if a target is vulnerable to fault injection attacks is a very simple program. So we see first the trigger up that tells us when to inject the glitch, and then a GPIO pin will be raised. And then we just execute a stream of add instructions, which at the end increase a counter, which will be sent back to the workstation. And then the hypothesis is, if this counter changes, then we affected the intended execution of this software, meaning that the chip is not robust against fault injection attacks. So we expect some outputs, of which these are three examples. So whenever we inject a glitch and it's too soft, the counter will not change. The counter will be 10,000. If we glitch too hard, then the counter cannot be sent back, because then the target either resets or it mutes, and then we only get the counter string back. And whenever we are successful, the actual counter value will change. So depending on what's happening inside the chip, this counter can be higher, lower. It can be a completely different value. And one thing, of course, to realize is that if you glitch too hard too often, then the target might actually damage permanently. And then you have to swap targets in order to continue. So there's one little thing you have to do first. So I told you about the trigger, so that is that GPIO signal that you see, and that defines actually the attack window. So we know for sure that within those two moments in time, the actual add instructions are being executed. So it does not matter to us when we exactly inject this glitch, because there will be multiple points within this attack window that are good. But we need to find out how hard to glitch. So what is too soft and what is too hard? So typically what we do is we randomize the voltage provided to the target and the glitch length, and how deep the dip in the power signal will go. So typically we try to go to zero, but due to capacitance, this is not always possible. But by randomizing this, we actually can determine what good parameters are. And typically what we do is we plot this. So what's happening here is, if I stop it for one brief moment, here on the y-axis is the glitch length, that is in orders of nanoseconds, and on the bottom is the glitch VCC, which is in VCC. And by actually randomizing the parameters and injecting glitches at that moment in time, we actually see that there's some sort of a relationship between these two parameters, being the glitch length and the glitch VCC. At the bottom right, you see the area where it's all green. So then the combination of these two parameters means that's too soft. On the top left, you see that it's yellow. So combination of these two parameters, it's too strong. But you see happening in between, you see some sort of a sweet spot occurring. So you see a curve there between the yellow area and the green area. And that's exactly where the parameters form a combination that allows us to affect the intended behavior of the software without affecting its continuation. So after the glitch, the target works perfectly. The only thing that happened is that the program executed differently. So if you run this for a very long time, you get very nice graphs. And for some targets, this relationships is different and nice patterns come up. But typically, you see something like this. So this tells us two things. Our setup is working correctly, so we hooked up all the wires fine, we modified the target correctly, and also the target is not robust against fault injection attacks. So this gives, this is a requirement if you want to use fault injection for something else. So let's stop this. So most secure embedded devices have something in order to protect the external contents in flash, and this is typically referred to as secure boot. So for example, if you look at this generic implementation, which will look very similar to most implementations you're going to find in the field, after the device is set on, we see that the first stage bootloader is loaded into SRAM by the CPU. And typically this is done by some software that is stored in the ROM, which is read-only memory. So that will be the first code that is executed after power on reset. And then the second stage bootloader is actually loaded into DDR, because typically the first stage bootloader is used to initialize the DDR. It cannot use directly after power reset. You need some software in order to do this. And of course, I already mentioned it, the contents in external flash are not protected. So something needs to be there in order to provide integrity or confidentiality. Otherwise, the attacker can change it and then take control over the device. So typically what they do, so I mentioned already, the ROM code is there, and this ROM code has access to a key. And it's important to realize that those two parts cannot change. So either the key is somehow tied to the chip, either by storing a hash, and the initial stage is stored in ROM, which is read-only memory. And effectively, they create a chain of trust, which is very similar to the PKI found in your browser, the difference being that there's only one root of trust here, typically. And so this root of trust is used to load the first stage bootloader, and this first stage bootloader is of course appended with a signature, which is then used to actually authenticate the first stage bootloader. A more complex variant is possible that the ROM code also has access to a symmetric key, which actually allows you to decrypt the first stage bootloader in order to provide confidentiality. So that prevents attackers from reverse engineering the software stored in external flash. However, in practice, a secure boot implementation does not consist of two stages or three stages. It typically consists of multiple stages. So for example, if you look at this ARM trusted firmware reference implementation, we see that there's multiple stages which are executed consecutively, which all have to authenticate each other in order to be sure that all software executed by the system after a power on reset is actually authenticated and trusted. But this makes you wonder, if there's so many stages involved, why don't you bypass secure boot logically? And I mean, that's very true, because I mean, throughout the last few years, we see numerous examples where actually secure boot implementations are being bypassed in a logical manner. These are two examples of this. However, one thing to realize is that typically, these early boot stages, which run under the highest privilege level, they consist on the they have a small code base, which means that there's a small logical attack surface. So it is likely, especially when the vendors take care and they make sure that they develop secure boot stages, the chances are high, much higher than, for example, the Linux kernel, which is a much larger code base, that there's no logical vulnerabilities present. And you need to leverage another type of attack in order to bypass secure boot if you want to do this. So in this type of attack, of course, is fault injection, and there's others. But this only makes sense to do this with such a sophisticated attack if there's something to gain during boot, which you cannot gain during runtime. So I will touch on that a little bit later. So there's a few disadvantages to fault injection. It is actually invasive, so you need to make modifications to the target. You also need physical access. It's very unlikely you can do this remotely, because you need to really have a physical presence to the target. And also compared to logical fault injection, it's expensive, so you need to have extra tooling, which of course is more expensive than if you would just use a kernel exploit in order to take control of the device. There are some advantages though. There is no logical vulnerability required, which we will touch upon later. Albert will show you this. And also the standard embedded technology of today, so everything you find in IoT, or almost anything you find in IoT, but also in other markets, is not well protected against fault injection. And this typically is because there is no solution that you can just integrate into your chip easily to prevent all these attacks. And especially if you consider multiple different type of fault injection, which all require a different type of countermeasure in order to counter the fault injection technique itself. And likely, and as I said, I mean, you need to gain something. So during boot, there might be assets available that are very interesting to gain, which you cannot get after the system is fully initialized. So typically, things you can access during boot are the ROM code, and this is the payload that is executed directly after power and reset. So it's smart to disable access to this ROM code when the system is fully initialized, and you typically see this. There might be keys available or stored, or the usage of these keys might be only possible during boot. For example, the keys used to decrypt the stages executed after boot. And also some functionality might actually be only available during boot. So you can think of the cryptographic engines that are used to decrypt the payloads originating from flash. So this was the introduction. I would like to give the word to my friend Albert, and he will continue.
Okay. Okay. So Nick just gave us an introduction on fault injection, and he gave us also an introduction to secure boot and why we need to do it, and why it needs to be there. So what we're now going to show you is some ways, some classic ways in which you can inject faults into secure boot and basically execute your own code. Okay. So if you have a secure boot implementation, at the end of the day, you're going to have to compare a computed hash against either a stored hash or a decrypted hash. So when this comparison happens, that's probably a nice place to inject some faults. So this bypass is applicable to pretty much all secure boot implementations, and it allows you to bypass that authentication. It does not actually allow you to bypass the encryption. Okay, so what does it look like? So here we have a snippet of code from the embed TLS project, and I'm not sure if everyone can read it. But here we have basically a memory compare of a computed hash against a stored hash. And if they're the same, we continue booting. And otherwise, we stop. We give an error. So this looks like a wonderful place to inject a fault. But what does this really look like if we compile it and disassemble it? So this is the code compiled and disassembled. I'm not sure if everyone can read it. But here's a memory compare. And then depending on the outcome of the memory compare, we either continue booting or fail. So in the C code, it looked like there was one place where we can inject a fault and bypass secure boot. But if we start looking here, there might actually be multiple places where we can bypass secure boot. So for instance, we could try skipping the memory compare, so not executing the memory compare. Perhaps we could try not executing that branch instruction. And there are actually a couple of more places where a single fault will allow us to completely bypass this check. And this is important, because there are multiple locations in which a single fault can completely bypass this check. Okay. Now, let's take a step back, and let's look at the calling function. So this is a piece of code, which sadly can't be that well read. But this piece of code is actually directly calling the code we just saw. So here we see embed TLS PK verify. And in that function is actually the memory compare we saw. And also here, we have an if instruction. And if it correctly verifies, we boot. And otherwise, we don't boot. And this code is quite similar to the code we already saw. So that probably means that there are also going to be multiple locations here where a single fault will allow us to bypass secure boot. So these bypasses, they can happen on all levels. They can happen inside functions, inside their calling functions, and inside their calling functions. OK, so I said we'd like to target these things with fault injection. But how do we actually find out during execution when these are? So I hope you all, after these couple of days, know what this is. This is a power trace of our secure boot implementation. It's an example trace of our own implementation. And we can actually see a number of things happening. And because it's our own implementation, we know exactly what's happening. So the first spike here is the copying of data from external flash into the chip. Then the second part is the decryption of that image and the authentication. And finally, we have serial outputs, which means the image has fully booted. OK, so we're looking for that moment in which this decision is made between executing this image and not executing it, between having proved that all the code is there and valid and it's not valid. So how can we find this? Well, we just use the normal image, take a power trace, and then we corrupt the image. And then we take another power trace. And then when they start to differ, before that point, we need to have injected our glitch. So in this case, we just need to inject our glitch just before the serial output, because that's very, very close to where that decision is going to be made. OK. So if you're an implementer and you find out that the image in flash is not correct, it's been corrupted, perhaps an attacker has placed something there, what do you do? What do you do when signature verification fails? A classic answer is to just enter an infinite loop. So we've updated our code from the previous example. We try to compute the signature and verify it. And then instead of not booting, we just go into while one, just an infinite loop. I mean, the target won't boot, so problem solved. But let's have a quick look at the way this, this code is compiled. So here we have our code to embed TLS PK verify. And if the signature is correct, we continue booting. And otherwise, we enter this infinite loop. But there is a problem. This infinite loop is actually directly above the correct code path. So if we manage to inject a fault into a single iteration of this infinite loop, we'll actually skip out and continue booting. And this is very nice for the attacker, because it means that timing is not an issue. You only have to hit that one iteration of an infinite loop. This is actually a classic smart card attack. And you know, in general, when you find out you have an invalid signature, it's probably better to reset the device or perhaps even to wipe keys. So I hope now everyone can read these power traces and can answer for themselves where we need to inject a fault to skip out of this infinite loop. And that's, of course, somewhere there. OK, so this is our last normal bypass, our last classic bypass, and that's secure boot enable. So as Nick introduced during the introduction, there is actually a piece of OTP in the chip, one-time programmable memory. And this typically contains quite a lot of security-sensitive settings. One of those settings is typically secure boot enable. And secure boot enable is used because when people develop on these boards, they don't want to be bothered with secure boot. But once everything's developed and it needs to be deployed to the field, they will enable this. They will enable secure boot. So typically, just after the CPU comes out of reset, something like the following code will run. Basically, the processor will fetch a value from some piece of memory mapped, a memory mapped region of a peripheral, and it will fetch basically the value: do I enable secure boot or not? Am I going to bother with all these hashes, all these hash checks, all that encryption? And if you look at it like this, you have that nice if. That's probably also a nice place to inject a fault. OK, so these were the classic bypasses, or all the classic bypasses. And these actually worked on multiple vendors' products. But those vendors have not sat still, and they've also come up with mitigations. And typically, these mitigations classically come from the smart card world, and they can be divided into two groups. The hardware countermeasures, where the goal is to actually detect a glitch as it's being injected into the chip, or that a fault has occurred. Now, if your hardware doesn't support these countermeasures, you can also do a number of things in software. However, countermeasures in software only lower the probability of a successful fault, but they can't completely rule it out. And they can't completely rule it out because they don't address the root cause. Basically, they can only detect that a fault has occurred. And at that point, you know, you're already running on unstable hardware. Yes. So with these software countermeasures, you can only lower the probability of a successful fault, but you cannot completely rule it out. So while these secure boot vendors are building all these countermeasures, they also use compilers, and they turn on compiler optimizations. And they do so because ROM memory size is limited. In the end, the ROM will directly go into the chip, and this costs real estate. This is wafer size, and this directly translates to the production costs of the device. And these compiler optimizations decrease the code size. So that sounds like a nice trade-off. However, the compiler can actually optimize out intended code. So I have some examples now, some classic examples. So here we have a double check. We've implemented two memory compares because it might be possible to actually skip out of one of them. We might actually bypass one memory compare, but then we check again, and you know, hopefully we'll actually find out that there was an issue, that there was a fault. So if we compare this with GCC without optimizations, we see actually that there are two memory compares. No problem. And then we compile it with optimization level 1. Oh, no. Oh, no. Our carefully constructed fault injection countermeasure has been removed. Yeah. So the compiler is, of course, allowed to do this because functionally nothing changes. However, since we're in the domain of side channel attacks, suddenly this behavior suddenly starts to matter a lot. So we have some best practices for you. The compiler is smarter than you, and it really can optimize quite nicely. But we can use volatile to prevent some of these optimizations. We can force it to actually perform these comparisons twice or multiple times using volatile. And therefore, we actually recommend that you actually read the output of your compiler at some of these critical places. OK, so I said you should use volatile, so I did. Here I use volatile, so here I have a volatile int pointer to some secure OTP value, and then we read it out twice. Now, something slightly unexpected happens when we compile it. Perhaps not that unexpected. We do actually get two loads from the same pointer. So at least the memory access is there. It's there twice. However, there is actually only one setup of the pointer. So this means it might still actually be possible to actually bypass secure boot, turn it on, with a single fault, because that pointer setup is only done once. So actually, the solution there is just to use the keyword volatile just a bunch of more times. OK. So these are some classic attacks. We also discussed their mitigations. And these mitigations have already been implemented in practice. However, the attack surface for secure boot is a lot larger. So let's move on to some advanced attacks. So our first advanced attack is called a combined attack. It's the category of combined attacks. And a combined attack is when you take one category of attack and use and combine it with another. So classically, this is using fault injection together with side channel analysis. But in our case, we'll be using logical exploitation together with fault injection. And we're going to take the easy approach here. And we're going to change the memcopy size argument. And we're basically going to build our own buffer overflow. So you can imagine, before the corruption, we have a memcopy which copies 1,000 hex from source to destination. And after the corruption, we'll hopefully copy more data, and we'll hopefully overwrite some critical variables. And the nice thing about this attack is that it actually works even when dedicated hardware is used to perform this copy, because we're targeting the parameters of the copy. So let's have a look at how that would work out. So here is our embedded system, as described by my colleague, Nick. So we have the bootloader 1.1 in flash, which will be copied to SRAM. And then the bootloader 1.2 will end up in DDR. However, there is something we failed to mention. It's that the SRAM probably also contains the stack for this entire secure boot procedure. So I think everyone can already see where this is going. OK, so here we have our code as it's running on the CPU. It's setting up the parameters, and then it will call memcopy. So our goal will be to corrupt that size argument and start overwriting stuff. OK, so we've prepared our flash. We have a payload in flash followed by a lot of pointers. So the payload is what we want to execute, and the pointers all point to that buffer in SRAM where our payload will be copied. Then as the system boots up, we introduce a fault. And hopefully, again, this fault will corrupt that size variable, and we'll copy more data. And then hopefully what will happen is we'll copy in the code, our code, followed by all those pointers. And when this function returns, one of those pointers will be popped from the stack and will actually jump directly to our code. So that all sounds nice, but we know about all these exploitation countermeasures. We know about stack canaries. We know about ASLR. We know about no execute. But sadly, these aren't really ever employed during early boot stages. So we can actually use classic stack smashing attacks without too much trouble. So I want to go back to this power trace. And also here, I want you to think, where do we need to inject a fault to actually get this behavior? And of course, it needs to corrupt those parameters. So just before we actually see a flash access, perhaps SPI, perhaps some NAND flash, just before that happens, that's where we need to glitch. OK, so the next combined attack is controlling PC on ARM. It's one of my favorites. And it exploits an ARM32 specific characteristic. And that characteristic is that the PC register is directly accessible by most instructions. So my colleague Nick already introduced these fault models. And he said, you know, it might be possible that when we inject a fault, we don't skip an instruction, but we actually just corrupt it. So let's try corrupting some instructions to see what can happen. So on ARM32, if you want to copy memory from A to B, and you want to do so quickly, you use these two instructions. And these are from the ARM reference manual. And that's load data multiple and store data multiple. And what the load will do is it will load data from the pointer R1, and it will load them into the registers R3 through R10. And then the store instruction will store to the pointer R0, and it will store registers 3 through R10 again. So if we want to actually perhaps add the PC register to this instruction, all we need to do is turn on a single bit. So if we flip that single bit from a 0 to a 1, we will actually add the PC register to the operand list. And instead of loading data into R3 through R10, we now load data in R3 through R10 and the PC register. When this happens, the processor will just directly go exactly to the attacker's code. Yeah. So this one's very architecture specific, but there are all these slight variations available on different architectures, but they're heavily dependent on the surrounding code. So let's have a look at this attack in practice. We've actually have exactly the same setup as before. We have our code followed by pointers in flash, and they will be copied into the system. But this time, instead of injecting a fault when we're setting up the parameters, we're going to inject a fault during the copy. And hopefully, during this copy, one of these pointers, And hopefully, during this copy, we'll actually have a fault, which will actually move one of these pointers directly into the PC register. And this will actually cause the processor to jump directly to our code. OK, so what's nice to see here is that actually, if there are any software countermeasures implemented against this, they will not work. Because once the fault is injected, we will no longer, boot ROM will no longer be executing, and you will directly be executing already the attacker's code. So actually, in fact, against this attack, it's not really possible to construct software-only fault injection countermeasures. And I really like this power trace. So what we do here is we look at when that copy is still occurring from flash. And at the end, and when our code has been copied in, but the flash pointers are being copied, that's when we try to inject a fault. And then hope for the best. OK. So my final combined attack is the wild jungle jump. And it's my personal favorite. So the basic attack is like this. You start glitching. Basically, any time after your data has been copied into the system, but before it's been fully decrypted or fully authenticated. And the idea is that there are lots of magic pointers around. And these magic pointers, they point quite close to your buffer, to your code, or somewhere around it. And we can get these magic pointers from anywhere. We can get them from the stack. We can get them from registers. We can get them from memory. And the only thing we actually need to do is make sure one of those magic pointers magically ends up in the PC register. And we'll have bypassed secure boot. And the more magic points there are in the system, the higher the probability of this actually working. So these are the combined attacks we wanted to talk about. So let me summarize. These combined attacks allow us to actually bypass both the authentication of an image, but also the decryption. And typically, there's little software exploitation mitigation during these early boot stages. So there's no ASLR. There are no stack cookies. There are no execute bits. And you know, these fault injection mitigations, which are implemented in software, might not actually be that effective. So this all sounds like we have, you know, a tremendous amount of power, a tremendous amount of opportunities, but there are some practicalities which we must overcome. So I'm now going to allow Nick to discuss these practicalities.
Thank you. So I would like to address these practicalities according to demonstration implementation, which is described here. So there's one big thing missing here. There's no root of trust. So it's not really a real secure boot implementation. But there's one authentication stage in there. So stage one has access to an RSA key, public key. It will load and authenticate stage two. And we actually invalidate stage two by printing a different string so we can identify it. So originally, there was something about black hat written there. But of course, we're not a black hat today. So in order to invalidate this image, we changed it to something else, which will hopefully be shown on screen. So again, we have the similar setup as here. One thing we failed to mention explicitly is that we actually take power measurements of this board using an EM probe. So that's the little probe you see denoted with the arrow. And this allows us to look into the chip what's going on. And these are actually real traces from this target. So we actually see that there's a small difference between the valid image and the invalid image. And you see that there at the end, there's a small spike missing. And this indicates to us where we want to glitch. However, to make this easier, we actually do the classic fail of entering an infinite loop. So for us, it does not really matter. If we look at these zoomed in traces, we see that the difference that we saw before is now much more clear, because in time we see less of what's going on. And that's actually the moment in time where you would want to glitch if you want to bypass the authentication. So if you want to, where the signature is being verified, there will be a path somewhere, either signature is valid, signature is not valid. That will be that moment in time. However, because we are entering an infinite loop, we can glitch basically anywhere after that moment, because the infinite loop is constantly running. So that's exactly what we will be doing for the second demo, which will be done live here on stage. We will actually target this infinite loop. So basically what we do, we power on the target. We wait long enough so that we're for sure in the infinite loop. So in this case, we wait around 500 or 600 milliseconds, I think. For the glitch parameters, because we know this target already a little bit, we know that there is this relationship between the glitch length and the glitch voltage. So in order to minimize the search space of these parameters, we actually fixed the glitch voltage, and we only randomize with the length. And in order to do it here on stage, the range of where we randomize is actually quite narrow. Typically, you would take maybe a bigger range in order to figure out what this parameter would be. But also one thing to realize is that even though you do characterization using a test application, if you target a chip at a different point in time, there will be more hardware initialized. And that means that the pattern you need in order to inject a glitch successfully will be different. So every time you have to redo this characterization in order to find these values. So this is really the setup that's laying here in front of us. And I will switch the screen to the setup.
No.
So, that's not possible. So basically, we talk to the glitcher using a Python wrapper that allows us to set the signals that are incoming and outgoing of this glitcher. Great. So what you see happening now is that every time it will reset and it will give a response. So what you see is that you actually, we do not get the black hat string anymore. It's only the string from U-boot. So U-boot is authenticating the next stage. And we're now trying to find the right parameters in order to actually go out of the infinite loop, because U-boot detected that there's something going on that is fishy and it enters this infinite loop. So if you're a little bit lucky, this will not take too long. But also one funny thing is always that we also have that actually in our lab, is that if the temperature changes, then the environmental conditions of the target changes, and also the glitch parameters change. So we prepared this demo yesterday night when it was very chilly. This morning it still worked, but I think now the tent is warming up with all the people and the sun, so this might become a problem. So let's try to increase the length a little bit. If this is not working now, we will just continue with the presentation and see if something happened once we're done with that. Typically, it would glitch once every 10 tries. Ah, there we go. So we finally, we successfully bypassed this weird bit. So it's maybe a bit early for beer, but I think we will drink a beer anyway. Okay, so Albert introduced various ways to actually bypass the secure boot implementations embedded devices, but there's certainly things vendors can do in order to make this much more difficult. And typically, that is what you want to go for. To prevent them as a whole is very difficult. Typically, you can only lower the probability for successful attacks, but you can certainly make it more difficult. So one of the things you want to do as an implementer of secure boot is you want to minimize the attack surface. So for example, you can authenticate all code and data. And that is logical, right? Because that's the prime feature of secure boot anyway. But also, you want to limit the functionality in ROM. Because the more functionality that is present there or executed during boot, the more opportunity or code constructions there potentially are that allow you to do some of the attacks Albert actually introduced. And also, you want to limit from the locations where you want to execute from, for example. You don't want to be able to execute from everywhere. You somehow want to restrict that, even during boot. And as Albert said, this is typically not done during boot, but it's really required if you want to prevent these type of attacks. And then already Albert, of course, touched upon it. You can lower the probability even further by implementing specific countermeasures. And this means that you can implement countermeasures for fault injection, so in hardware or software. But you can also reuse all the knowledge there's from the software exploitation part. Because some of the attacks that Albert touched upon, they actually leverage software exploitation. So if you make that part more difficult, then also using these fault injection attacks to combine them with software exploitation, it will be much more difficult. And typically, determining how good your design is very difficult to do from a paper study. So you can say something about it, but in order to really figure out what's going on, you really need to do testing. Because typically, what we state is that you really have to expect the unexpected, and sometimes it's very difficult to do upfront. This was it. Thank you very much. I hope you liked it. And we're going for a beer. Before we answer some questions, feel free to come to the States to look at this. Also, come by to our village. It's on the hopper field. It's over the dike to the left. There will be a big white tent, and you'll see this type of hardware laying around because colleagues of us are also busy with it. And yeah, if you have any questions, please let us know.
We have a microphone in the middle of the tent, or if you're far away, I can bring you this one too.
Yeah, we want to drink beer too.
No question, impossible.
What voltage supply do you actually inject faults? Because these FPGAs typically have 3, 4, 5 power supplies,
yeah.
Power rails.
Yeah. When the schematics of the device are public, you can read it from the schematic in order which power supply you actually need to use to affect the ARM core. If it's not public, you need to figure this out by, I would call it PCB reverse engineering and making some educated guesses what goes where.
So you're fault injecting the internal power supply, not IO. Not
Yeah, so it's really the power rail that provides direct power to the ARM core.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
No problem.
Another question? Anyone? No? Really not?
Thanks a lot.
Okay.